Okay, great. We have an agenda that we're going to cover today, and we start out with the select board. And I don't know whether anybody has comments, but that's first on our agenda.
So I can jump in real quick. So I know that the board has been, well, I should say the chair and I, because I can't say the board because that's open meeting law infractions out the wazoo. But the chair and I have been discussing plans to open more conversations around DEI for the board. You know, whether we hold an individual kickoff that then creates a series of conversations, or however we're going to do it, we're discussing that now. And so I'm hoping in due time that we can bring it to this committee to have to start to, you know, figure things out with this committee as well. We've been, you know, trying to basically hold off for a meeting essentially so that we can get to the election and have the new full board in place, and that way moving forward we can have you know, Mike Espejo's you know, input as well into the decision-making process. But otherwise, since we all last spoke, I had the opportunity to log into Ray Porch's Let's Talk About It session. My wife has been attending those, and I popped into the last one and had a great conversation with Ray and Patrick Larkin. And I was also invited to sit down with Ken Gordon on his show, Rapping with the Rep. And he had invited Mayor Arrigo and Dr. Barros from Revere. And it was fantastic listening to them talk about everything that they've been working towards in Revere in terms of bringing more equity and inclusion to the city of Revere and their, you know, city hall. And for me, and again, like I've been learning about, you know, the notion of everyone being on, you know, their own particular journey and that we're all in different places. But I learned the phrase intent and impact. And I felt like that was a really, really powerful, you know, phrase, especially as like, you know, as a white man trying to put things into context for myself. I felt like that was very powerful in terms of framing some of the discussion. So I just wanted to share that.
Thank you. Any other comments?
Well, for me, I wasn't able to go to or watch yet the most recent select board meeting, but just from kind of peripheral other news, there was a little bit of discussion of what happened a few meetings ago, isn't that right? Didn't it come up kind of in a side, not really a side conversation, but Jim did bring it up at least temporarily, right? Or just in a brief discussion, isn't that right, Nick?
Yeah, it was a non-agenda item. You know, I had written a statement that I was going to read during my subcommittee meeting or subcommittee time. But then Jim had opened with, you know, a verbal apology. And so I asked if it was all right to just read my statement at that point in time. You know, moving forward, I think the goal is going to be to try to make sure whenever we're talking about, you know, really anything, let's be honest, you know, that we're following Robert's rules of order and that we're making sure it's on the agenda as an item. Otherwise, it needs to be placed under new business. But yes, Carl, answer your question.
I was glad. I mean, I still need to go to the BCAT site and watch what was said, but I was glad to hear that it was at least acknowledged, and at least from Jim's statement, the apology was given. I'm not sure, PJ, how you feel about that.
Well, it's interesting because I was not invited to the meeting. I've not had an apology. And what I have managed over the last couple of weeks are responding to, I had 44 different emails to to share the presentation and to provide a copy of the 14-page report. And so I'm still waiting to hear, because I presented both a written letter and then an email through Nick what the opportunities are, and I've not heard back.
Yeah, I will just jump in here and say I assume there would be an agenda
if I
item.
Can jump in here quickly. I think that's key, right?
Go ahead.
Saeed, did you want to say something? I was just saying I wish it had been an agenda item, because I don't think any of, I mean, of course Nick was there, but the rest of us didn't know. And as BJ said, she hasn't gotten a direct response to her email or direct apology. So Nick, you can maybe speak to this if it's upcoming in a future meeting. Or I would actually like to, and you mentioned that, you know, we should have some conversations directly. You mentioned meeting after election, which, I mean, I would prefer sooner, but yeah, even if it's after election, that's not that far off, but let's make sure we get something on the schedule. I think a special session is needed, because we really need to talk, not just to you, but to the other board members, and they need to talk to us, because it's been more than 2 weeks, and we haven't heard anything directly.
Any other comments?
I see Saeed back in the room. I don't know if he wanted to say.
His name is still there, but I haven't heard anything. Have you?
No, he's still on mute.
Okay.
Yeah, you know, I, as it stands, I am one member of a 5-member board, you know, and recommendations of one, you know, only go so far. You know, I'm trying to continue to have conversations. I'm hoping that, you know, we can get through this next meeting in March, and then following that, our next full meeting will be the Monday after the election, at which point, you know, I'm hoping that we can open the discussion and, you know, like you said, Nancy, set time for a special meeting, as I had recommended in at the last meeting. You know, I had said whether it be a special meeting or you know, continued conversations, whatever it needs to be, whatever it should be, you know, we can work toward that. So from my position, more to come.
Nick, just to clarify, that's April 11th. Is that the next one after the election, or the first one after the election?
It should be. It should be. Usually the election falls, and then the Monday immediately after there's a meeting. And seeing as March 28th is our last meeting, our last regular meeting before the election, I would imagine that's it.
Okay, thanks.
Confirm that for everybody.
May I ask, and I'm asking this on behalf of BJ, are there plans to, you know, give her a formal apology? I understand there were some apologies at the last select board meeting, but I feel like she needs one that's formal from all the board members.
Yeah,
she deserves one.
I agree. I don't know where that stands. I'm trying to gain final understanding of, you know, if a verbal or written apology is going to be, you know, formally addressed.
Thank you. Let's go on to item 2.
My apologies, BJ. I dropped off because my connection got bad. So can folks hear me now? I've dialed in through the phone service now.
Yes, you're on. We can hear you. Thank
awesome.
You.
Awesome, thank you. I have a quick comment in case it's like I said, I was cut off, so I don't know if the signals dropped, so I don't know if this has already been covered. But the last thing I heard was when Carl was saying what your thoughts were, BJ, in terms of the apology that, you know, has been publicly issued, but not to you, and that you have not obviously heard back from the select board on your offer. So I was only going to make a comment that yes, obviously it's good if they apologize to you as well. And the bigger point or the bigger cause here is to how to help the select board learn and grow from this experience. And yes, so what that means is they need to respond to your offer. Either way, whether, you know, they would like to take you up on the offer or not. That's my comment. Thank you.
Thank you. Second item we have on the agenda are the key executives on the organizational chart. The one that I received, I think I passed it on. It's boxes. And on the chart, this is what came from Sherry. And it just has the name of the organization. It's a title of who the person is, but it does not present their name, and there's no phone number. I have another document that came from Joanne Faust, and it says search directory for staff, and it provides the name and a phone number, but it's the name of the organization, not the person. So those two have not been combined. As an example, on the list it has administration select board and a phone number, assessor's office and a phone number, finance and a phone number. But we still don't know who's in charge of these organizations. What's the name of the executive that's managing the whole process? So are there any suggestions? Do we return to Joanne and have her fill out a complete list with the title, the name, and the phone number? Or is there another strategy?
If we're just looking for executive leadership, we're talking about town administrator Paul Sagarino, town accountant / assistant town administrator John Denizio, the central admin office, so Lynn Mills and the folks in that office, and the select board. Beyond that, we're talking about departmental directors. You know, I would say that for our conversations, having Amy Warfield and Joanne Faust involved are absolutely necessary, given that, you know, Amy is still an elected role, and Joanne is human resources. And then from there, it's a question of how far we want to take it with that group of folks, and if we want to include the elected boards of all the other departments. Right. So because beyond that, you know, Board of Health is run by the Board of Health, and the schools are run by the school committee, and planning is run by the planning board. And so, you know, the purview of the select board as executive leadership begins to diminish based on elected official status. So I guess how wide of a net do we want to cast?
We want to cast a broad net because we're looking at the executive that makes the key decision about what's in policies and procedures and how they manage employees and the data that's collected for that part of the organization. They're in control of all the employees. So
are we looking for data or are we looking for policymakers?
Both.
Okay, so
the reason I'm saying both is, yes, HR handles policies and procedures, but but you also look at the leader that has the ability to do the application of policies and procedures. And they're making decisions about their own employees. And so we need to have the conversation with them about what might need to be changed in their organization.
I'm not pausing for effect, I'm pausing to think. So at least in the last two policies that I've helped establish here, the select board did it, and then and now we're asking other other boards and committees to adopt it. So I'm just trying to think through logistically, because I mean, you know, if you're talking about involving every board that is a policymaker, you're talking about 7 planning board members, 5 select board members, 5 board of health members, 5 school committee members, right? So like in terms of like getting to a resolved action, I don't want to put so many cooks in the kitchen that it becomes ineffective, right? So I'm trying to like think about like where can we reduce the net for a first pass in terms of the policy itself, in terms of data collection, you know, I'm trying to think that through too. That might warrant a conversation with Joanne and Paul just to determine how, you know, at least the departments within, under the selectman's purview, the select board's purview, function. And then we can go to each of the boards to learn more.
I'll take your suggestion. When I worked in higher education, I always reported to the president, and as the executive director of human resources, I had the oversight and the application of all policy and procedure. And so any policies that were rewritten, it was shared with the dean of students as well as vice presidents. And that's the level at which decisions are made about policy procedure. When you look at the practice of how it's applied in the organization, that's a lower level of management. And all I'm using is the term key executives because I don't know any other way to phrase it.
Right. And I guess what I'm trying to say is that the structure you're used to is not as, like, it's not as vertical here. It's way more horizontal and way more convoluted. And you know, so what I'm trying to say is like, how can we take what you're accustomed to and find a way to adapt it into the way government is structured to be effective, right? Because we could easily just say, you know what, like we want a member from every board and committee and we're going to round you up and have a conversation, but I think that's going to be wildly ineffectual. You know, so we have to be much more targeted and focused as to how we roll this out, because even to your point, the select board sets the policy and the state sets the policy and HR just enforces it, right? HR isn't creating anything new that isn't already set by the state or local lawmakers or policymakers. So I mean, and Carl, Nancy, Saeed, like, even if you guys have any suggestions, I mean, like, I'm not even, like, because my natural reaction is start with the select board, and from a policy standpoint, and, you know, if we want to look at it from a data standpoint, we can talk to the directors of the departments, but, like, if we keep it there in that box and kind of, like, iron out the wrinkles, then we can, you know, shop it to other boards and committees and their staff. And, you know, see where things do and don't work before we, you know, come to a final resolution on what we think it needs to be.
So you're position is that you think the decisions about policy and procedure is with the select board, the five members that I met with.
For some things, is I think is what Nick's trying to say, for some things, and then the, for, it depends on where we want to go. And Nick, correct me if I'm wrong about this because you have more expertise, but different policies are set by different boards, and the select board has certain oversight on certain things, and the school committee has certain oversight on things. And the select board might be a good place to start, but we're not going to get everything that we need from that body. And then once we have a conversation or two or three with the select board, then maybe we can move on. I think that our path is going to be long because we're not going to be able to have just one conversation with one executive or one body because of how spread out it is in town. Am I right?
To put it into further context, right? The school committee is doing an equity audit.
Right.
And that has nothing to do with the select board, and the outcome of that information is strictly tied to the school district, right? So the school committee from that audit could set policy that affects only the school district, right? Could the town adapt and adopt things to create their own policy? Absolutely. But one hand is not necessarily, you know, this is, it's like the world's weirdest magic trick. You know, the left hand and the right hand are operating completely independently of each other in a lot of respects. And that's happening, you know, and like I said, you've got school committee, board of health, planning board, select board. What other elected boards are there? Like those are the top ones that come to mind, right? And then town clerk is an elected position. You know, so again, I mean, like there's, this is why, like, I wish it was more simple, you know, so it wouldn't require so much, you know, stretching of effort. But that's, I mean, I wish I had a better answer.
Also, go ahead.
Yeah, I just want to say, I think part of the reason we brought that chart up though is just to have one for the town too, whether we only talk to the select board or whatever you know, path we go, but just even to have that chart filled out would be good for everyone. So
yes, I agree.
That's one thing. And if, yeah, Joanne and Amy can work on that, I think that would make sense.
I'm even happy to help plug holes.
Okay.
You know, it's, I mean, you know, that's, that task is fairly straightforward. I can at least, I can easily do the directors. I'm not, you know, staff wise, I don't know everybody. But yeah, in terms of, you know, forward momentum and answering your question, BJ, you know, our immediate executive leadership is the select board, the town administrator, Paul Sagarino, the assistant town administrator, John Denizio. And then I would also include Amy Warfield and Joanne in that grouping, given the context of everything that we're discussing.
I think that Joanne is the person that should work with us in defining this and creating the data that we need.
Well, again, if we're just looking for names, you know, I mean, I can do a lot of that legwork for you if you'd like.
Just point of clarification, I'm trying to find the chart in my emails. Is that something that you sent to us, BJ?
Mine came to me from Sherry Ellis.
Oh, let me search a different way.
I can send you the email she sent to me. I don't have an issue with that. It's been in the last couple of weeks.
Yeah, I don't see it here. If you don't mind, that late, maybe after the meeting would be fine.
Okay.
Thank you.
And I guess based on the comments that you've made, when I look at policy and procedure, that's a guidance that's presented for everyone who is employed here in Burlington. And they may work in different departments serving different boards, but the policies of how people are treated should be the same.
I agree wholeheartedly. That's just not how it works, right? So the school committee does not have to adopt the same policies that the select board has. The unions themselves don't have to adopt certain things. You know, I mean, as we've discussed, right, like there are this language that we'd like to introduce into just into negotiations, but that's it. It could stop at negotiations, right? The unions don't have to accept that. The hope is that through negotiations, they will, you know, because it makes sense and it's, you know, good common practice. But, you know, this is the biggest pain point, I think, for a lot of folks. And it was absolutely a huge one for me when I started out in local government, is that it's wildly horizontal in terms of structure, and it's way more convoluted in terms of you know, the overall organizational structure, you know, because there are I could also be speaking slightly, I'm not going to say this is a blanket thing, I could be slightly speaking out of turn, because if it's an HR policy that we're putting into effect, it could very well affect everyone who is automatically non-union, therefore covering off on a lot of bases. But then we just have to look at who's union versus who's not. But regardless, it all starts with the select board and HR.
Agreed. Next item on our agenda, the scorecard, a DEI statement, and union contracts. We gathered that information from the documents that we shared among ourselves. And our take on that is that every union contract comes to an end June 30th, 2022. Since we have so many union contracts, I'm not sure who does the negotiation. Is it an attorney that negotiates every contract? Or do the boards or the office that's running the employees have a chief negotiator that they bring on board? I don't know how that's done.
To be honest, I'm not 100% sure how it's done either, because I've never been a part of the negotiations up to this point. But I will make that a line item for me to ask and gain clarification on who sits at the negotiating table. I do know that our town administration is, so Paul and John are a part of the conversations at the very least from the town side. So, you know, if we were a draft language that the select board approved, that would very much make it into the conversation. I do apologize. I have to jump ahead to Fox Hill for my parent-teacher conferences. But before I go, the one thing I wanted to say, and I'm bummed that I can't be a part of this conversation, but we have the three things in the document: the scorecard, the DEI statement, and the union contracts. My recommendation would be that we create three subcommittees with two members each to work through those three things separately, and then come back together for a group committee review. So just going to put that there before I run and I get apologies.
Okay. See ya.
All right, Nick. See ya.
That was an interesting approach. His saying that we should have three committees that address scorecard, DEI statement, and union contracts.
What I think the one advantage to that, not trying to endorse or not at this point, but one advantage would be that if each of us, or if two members are on each of these subcommittees, I guess it would be subcommittee of a subcommittee. We're getting down into the weeds right there. You know, the two of us can correspond over email.
Right, if all five of us talk on email, that's a violation of open meeting law. And I know that we need to be more aware of that as a group. But if two of us correspond, that's not a violation. We can, like if Nancy and I talk over email, that's okay, because it's not a quorum. And I think that, that's one advantage of that, is that we could have discussions more frequently and not have to wait until the whole committee meets. And come up with ideas and suggestions to bring in front of all of us at an open meeting.
Okay. Nancy, any thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, I assume that was why Nick made that suggestion too, just to have more leeway as far as being able to work freely without having to meet as a group. I guess just looking at those three pieces though, I mean, I don't know how much expertise I have in any one of those, so yeah, I don't know how you would want to split people up on that.
I don't know either, but I have created the diversity scorecard for a university. I did it over an 8-year period, so I know what goes into the scorecard. For the select board statement, that's the DEI statement, we wrote a draft. I wrote a draft for that. And based on the meeting I had on the 28th, I don't know whether they accepted it or rejected it or where we stand on any statement, any language, not there. But at least I made the effort to do that. And in terms of union contract negotiation, I have been the executive that has been in the camp to reject unions coming into an organization, engaging in a period to address it before the vote comes up. And in universities where I've worked, we've avoided that 3 or 4 times in my time frame of doing that. And in those same universities, if a union is already present and has been there for a number of years, 25 years, 40 years, representing employees, then I was the chief negotiator, representing management for all of the contract negotiations. So I have experience in all three committees.
So then would it make sense for you to pair up with a different person on each of those? Is that allowed? I don't really know what.
And would you want, that's a lot to take on.
I know, so. And if you even want that.
I'm okay doing it that way. Because the two that are at the top, contract negotiations are going to be taking place right away.
If not already, I was under the assumption that they were already, and then I guess it's dangerous to make assumptions without confirming, but to speak to Nick's earlier point, it was my understanding that it was town administrators and town council that are the negotiators, but I'm not 100% sure on that.
Depends on where they are.
Right.
And I have no idea how the negotiations go here for as many contracts that are being negotiated simultaneously. Depends on who's in charge, whether it's legal counsel or somebody they've hired to bring in to do the negotiation. I have no idea. And working with the select board on the statement, that's at the top of the list.
But it's kind of like you said, you already wrote a version, it's in their court, which is why I was kind of trying to get Nick to say more about committing to, you know, either a special session or at least a agenda item. And again, I am very frustrated that they haven't done a direct apology, especially to you, BJ, but even just to the whole committee. Of course, we've heard from Nick a bunch, but that's just Nick. He's not the whole board. And I understand he was saying that, well, it's hard for him as one out of five. But I guess it sounds like they want to wait till after the election, so that'll be a few more weeks. So yeah, as far as my point was, as far as working on a DEI statement, is there really something to do right now if it's kind of just, there is a DEI statement, we need to, you know, I think the wording's pretty sound, they just need to work on, you know, what do people want to accept or change there. But it's kind of hard to do anything if, you know, we're talking amongst ourselves about it and they haven't responded or aren't working with us directly.
Yeah.
I wonder if, oh, sorry, BJ, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, Nick talked about having open conversations and educating the select board. That's a piece of this too.
Yeah.
Right. I wonder if he's trying to wait until after the election because of the new makeup of the board. Might be more open to some of the work we're trying to do. I'm just speculating.
Sure. I mean, that makes sense, but they could apologize still.
That's, yeah, absolutely. You're right.
Whether it's a letter or an agenda on the next item on the agenda next time. Because, yeah, we didn't know that. I would have at least dialed in if I knew that they were going to apologize. So my thoughts are just, it's kind of difficult to move forward when the other party isn't really participating or we're not able to connect with them. And I know part of it's OML, but it's a little bit frustrating because it's been a few weeks since PJ's presentation and we haven't really moved on from that.
Yeah.
And that's the part that's troubling me also, Nancy, to be very honest with you. Mm-hmm. I've been listening to everybody's comments here. Yes, we need to get these things done. We are all raring to go. But if the select board isn't on board, no pun intended, then is that helpful? Because the last thing I'm sure any one of us wants is another monkey wrench being thrown into this whole process.
One of the things that I learned about in the last week is that I got an email saying that there was a presentation in a Burlington newspaper about what happened at the select board. And I didn't know the name of the paper, but I went to CBS and they had one paper and there wasn't anything in it. I went to the book place that's close to CBS, they had no Burlington newspapers. I went to Shaw's to look for a Burlington newspaper, and they didn't have it either. So I came home and I looked up Burlington newspapers on the computer, and I found one, and there were three articles. One was on Ray Porch, and the other two were different presentations. One was what happened at the select board, and then the other one, what I presented, and some elements that were in the report that we submitted. I was asked to meet with a reporter, and I said no, that my communication is with the committee and with the select board, and that I did not want to address an item in the newspaper. That's not how I operate. And the woman who sent me the chart was interviewed in one of those newspaper articles. And so instead of continuing to communicate, I canceled a meeting so that I won't communicate, because she is communicating to the board and the newspaper. our different way of operating does not hold us with the same approach to deal with the issue. So we have to decide, we have to have the select board decide, where are we going? What are we going to do? How are we going to approach this?
Yeah, and because of scheduling things, like even if it is not going to be till after the election, I feel like we need to get that date on the calendar now, like if it's going to be like within a month. Like,
well, we've lost 3 weeks.
Yeah, and like just, I don't want
another three before the ninth.
Yeah, and I don't want any excuses like, oh no, we're already booked up, you know, or we don't have time, or maybe we can meet in May or something. Like, I don't want that to happen.
The third item that Nick suggested was the scorecard. And I presented you with the documents that I produced. So I have a sense of what should be in the scorecard, but that needs to be affirmed. And until we begin to work out what's the policy, the procedure, what's being negotiated in contracts, and we begin to develop the strategy that we're going to approach, do we decide what could be in the scorecard? Because the scorecard is created after the first year of the efforts that are put forward. So we can do the scorecard, but it's not as immediate as working with the select board and finding out where we are on union contract negotiations. Any other thoughts?
I'm just like I don't know too much about the union stuff, and it seems like not anyone else does either, but it's like, would we even be able to give any input, or are they just kind of like, no, this is, we're already taking care of it? I wonder about that.
Well, if they're presenting a document they would like to be included in a union contract, I would like for this committee to review it before they put it for negotiations. At least that's my.
At the very least, for us to have one of these conversations at the select board and say, very simply, this is what we recommend, and we will. For we can ask the question: where are the? I guess we can just start with that. Where are the negotiations at currently? And this is what we recommend: language to be added as a possible negotiation point. Otherwise, it's another 3 years before there's another opportunity.
It may not be that much, because it looks like some of these contracts end every year.
Oh, once. Okay. Okay.
I don't know about them all, but, and that's frequent.
Right.
Very frequent. I mean, you can have 2 and 3 year contracts, and that it's a different approach. So, but I think we.
I'm gonna jump.
Go ahead.
Sorry to cut you off, Vijay. I thought you were done. This may be my lack of information about how municipal governments work. So please pardon me if this is a dumb question, but I need to understand so that I can, you know, so that I know. Why do we have to wait till the next select board meeting to ask these questions? Can we not I believe we already have the email addresses of all the select board members. Why can we not share these thoughts via email and still be within be in compliance with the OML?
That might be part of it.
I would just assume that stuff needs to be discussed publicly, because it's like the whole select board and then the whole committee and
right.
That's
now that I'm thinking about it, that's exactly what it is. We could send it to them, but we wouldn't be able to expect an answer.
Yeah. Like, that's why I want to have a special session that's not just like, oh, we got 10 minutes on the agenda. I want a full meeting, because there's a lot to talk about. Like, they haven't interacted with us except for, you know, criticizing BJ and attacking.
I hear you. So essentially, okay, that makes sense that it there cannot be a discussion over email, but we can at least share our thoughts with them, right? And let them give them, I guess, a peace of mind, for lack of a better phrase, in advance, so that they can at least mull it over and be ready for a conversation.
Yeah, I think
I agree with you. And I agree with you, Nancy, this is probably going to be a long, you know, either a significant majority of the agenda or an agenda or a one agenda item meeting, either or.
Yeah, so like you said, Saeed, we could send them something, but yeah, we couldn't really discuss or go back and forth in email.
Information is limited. Today is the 23rd, Wednesday the 23rd of March. The next select board meeting is the 28th of March.
Yep.
Yes.
The next DEI committee meeting is the 6th of April.
Yes.
And the vote is being taken on April 9th. That's a Saturday.
Yeah, that's the election, yes.
My hunch is that then the select board meets on the 11th of April.
Yep.
Yes.
So do you want to meet with the select board on the 28th of March or the 11th of April?
Nick seemed to be leaning toward the 11th of April as better for us, but now I also, they have to post agendas. I'm not sure when the select board agendas are normally posted, but at least 48 hours in advance. And I think since they meet on Mondays, it has to be done probably by close of business on a Thursday to give two full, well, maybe not, maybe. This is a question for Nick, when the agendas for select board meetings have to be posted.
For the select board on the 28th of February, I gave it the Tuesday before.
The Tuesday, okay. It might be too late to get on the meeting for the 28th of March.
But the 5th of April is when Lynn has to get our request to be on the agenda and what the content is.
For the April 11th meeting?
Yes.
I wonder if we can still...
That's the day before our next meeting.
Yes. Our next meeting is the 6th.
I was going to say, I mean, if we're not presenting any additional info, can we still get on the agenda?
Could we? Yeah, we could keep it. Sorry, Nancy.
Yeah, just to have some time. Sorry, I really want that apology. I'm kind of outraged. You know, it's not cool to be like, oh, yeah, I'm sorry, but then you didn't even let people know that you're trying to apologize to, and then we hear about it afterwards or read about it in the paper, and kind of counterproductive or not as effective. And yeah, some sort of response to BJ's letter.
Well, Nick would have to talk with them. I'm not going to try and get on the schedule.
No, you don't. You shouldn't have to. No, you shouldn't have to. That's why I'm trying to push for that, because, yeah, you should not have to ask for anything. They should know what they need to do.
They're still trying to decide what to do.
But at the same time, I hear what you're saying, and I agree. But shouldn't we try to be proactive and at least say, put us on the agenda for April 11th, and just make that request now, so we're at least on the agenda. They can have some time to plan to say whatever they're going to say or not say. But
yeah,
we can start asking these questions that we have tonight.
Yeah, I think that's reasonable. I mean, at least, because I don't know if there's any chance for anything on the March 28th, but yeah, at least for the April 11th, yeah, it'd be nice to, you know, if that's what we can get, we can at least get a few minutes there or some sort of continuation of our connection.
Well, it's an apology, but it's also, what do they want to have happen with diversity, equity, and inclusion? To create a committee and say that we're limited to 1 year, and when you go to present the first time, to be knocked off the block, doesn't say they're committed.
Right.
So it's more than apology. They have to think about where they want to go with this.
Yeah.
Next item on the list is the minutes. What do you want to say, Carl?
I move that we approve the minutes from our March 9th meeting, unless there are any edits that I need to make.
Second.
We have to say that we're approving or not approving.
We have to do a roll call vote, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay.
BJ, yes.
Nancy, yes.
Carl, yes.
Yes.
Said yes. Okay, thank you all. I will submit them to Town Hall.
Thanks, Carl.
Our next DEI meeting is scheduled for the 6th of April. Is everybody okay with that?
Two thumbs up.
Yes.
Yep. Okay,
yes,
with that.
Yes.
I just have a quick note to make here. So Ramadan starts around the 2nd of April. So, and so as some of you may already know, we break our fast at sundown. So I may have to drop early for some of the meetings during Ramadan. So just bear with me, please.
Yes, of course.
Absolutely.
Of course.
And a question that I have, so we clearly have some foundational issues to resolve here with the select board, right? What do they want from the DEI committee? Do they want a DEI initiative or not? And so on and so forth. Are we going to be meeting? Are we going to be holding off on getting any sort of an answer till the next meeting in 2 weeks' time? Or is there anything else that's happening in the meantime to help us get some sense of direction?
Well, that's kind of what we were talking about. Like, is it possible for them to give us a few minutes at the next meeting, which was on March 28th, or like we were trying to figure out?
No, I know. I know, Nancy. I know. I'm sorry. I should clarify. So I know. I obviously am listening to the whole conversation here, right? So yes, And as Carl was saying, I was doing the math in my own head. In my own head, we probably missed the cutoff point to be added to the agenda, because if my math is right, two business days before Monday's meeting is essentially the end of the day today, which the business day is over. And
yeah.
So, go ahead, BJ.
I was agreeing.
Oh, okay. So yeah, so. I guess I just don't know how to express this, but except for it's kind of frustrating to not know exactly what the select board wants from us. And does there need to be a special meeting, or you know, as long as it's allowed under, you know, whatever applicable municipal laws there are, to get a sense of, or get some of these important questions answered.
Yeah,
because if
that,
there
that
is
was
because
weird.
If there is no, yeah, because if there's no, we cannot be twiddling on our thumbs, you know, to be very blunt. And these are all important tasks which require a lot of time, energy, effort, and if I may add, tears and blood and sweat. So we need to know what does the town want? What does the governing body of the town want?
Yeah, I absolutely agree. And that's why I was talking about I guess they call it a special session. So a meeting between maybe just our, you know, committee and the board, but of course it's open to the public. So just being able to schedule that, but Nick already said probably that wouldn't be till after the election.
No, we could also just go to the March 28th meeting and start asking questions during new business, or they also have citizens time at the end. Would require sitting through the whole thing or showing up at some point in the middle and waiting until citizens time. We could at least ask some of these questions. I don't know if that would actually help or hurt our efforts, but if we could get some answers.
I mean, can Nick...
It's a radical... Go ahead, Nancy.
I was just going to say, I wonder if Nick can say something as, you know, a member of the subcommittee, and, you know, because don't they do reports, or they can do reports, and then he can at least say something at that point? I mean, I guess we need to ask him. But yeah, I know I like Carl's radical approach as he thinks. Just like show up and start. What do you want?
I think Carl's approach is radical. If the committee members are willing to go to the meeting, I'll go to the meeting on the 28th. I don't think we should have to wait until April.
Yeah.
I agree partially. It would be kind of a show of force, right?
Yes.
But Carl has a valid point that it may not help our cause.
Yeah.
Because
I guess
it may seem like it's reactionary.
Yeah, we Nick's opinion. I mean, they already feel like we're attacking them, right? So.
Right.
Yeah, I know. You kind of have to play nice or play the game.
And I hate that, but.
Yeah. But I mean, we could still at least speak up and just say hello and hey, we're still here.
Even you know, it's making a statement just going there and sitting there, and mm-hmm. as a subcommittee, just showing our face. If they want to do the right thing, they might make an apology right then and there. They could invite, I don't know what would happen, if anything. I don't know if it's not on the agenda, how tied are they to the agenda? You know, some are, I think, more rule followers than others. And so it could be that Jim says, hey, do you want to say something? Or do you have, I don't know. I don't know what would happen if we go. But my Monday nights are free usually, so I could meet you all there.
I'm willing to go, but not by myself.
Yeah, if we decide to go, I can come too.
So if we're going to be there on the 28th of February, I got there at 5:35 before the meeting ever started. No one was in the room. Because I wanted to be prepared for what the layout was like and how the meeting would run and who was going to participate. And I'm willing to go and be there and sit through the entire meeting. But I don't want to do it alone, because I'm not doing this work alone. This is a committee and they have to accept all of us.
And that's fair, BJ. That makes perfect sense. I just think that it won't help us, no being there and asking questions during citizens' time.
Okay.
That's my opinion.
Well, maybe we should follow up with Nick and see what he thinks. Maybe he can just say a few words on our behalf, at least.
Well, he's saying wait until after the 9th.
I know, he said that.
Well, it's 2 months. We'll wait 2 more months for them to decide whether they want to do something or not. So we can just wait.
About this thought, I honestly think we need to suspend our meeting until and unless we have some, you know, important task to discuss or some preparatory work to work on or to take care of. And I think that in and of itself will be a strong statement to the select board and to the public that we need the select board to let us know exactly what are we still authorized, entrusted to do what this committee was created for. And if and until we get that, you know, approval or, you know, confirmation or whatnot based on what happened in the meeting where Vijay, you were there in person and the rest of us are online, it makes no sense for us to move forward because we don't know how to move forward. Actually, let me rephrase. Not that we don't know how to move forward. We know how to move forward. We don't know if we have the select boards, if they're you know, a willing participant in this process or not.
I think that I feel your frustration, and I hear and I share it. And as frustrating as it is to wait, I think part of it is a politically practical delay until I think that once the election is over, there will be at least three who are supportive of what are 100% supportive of what we're trying to do. And that's a majority. And so maybe it is a politically practical move just to wait until the 11th, as frustrating as that is.
So the 11th of April, to be precise, correct?
Yes.
Right, so that's 2 weeks approximately.
So we will cancel the 6th of April. There's no meeting for this committee until after the select board meets on the 11th. Correct?
That makes sense to me.
Well, I was thinking the other approach is if that is the first, April 11th is the first meeting with a new select board, April 6th we could, you know, or we could request something on the 11th, and maybe April 6th is what we figure out what we want to say and whether it's just...
We could use that time to prepare.
Yeah, and reintroducing ourselves, you know, especially with the new makeup of the committee, and I don't know, that's another thought. So we could go wait, not do any more work because it's, you know, we're not really able to, you know, utilize our time efficiently if we don't even know what they want and we can't work with them directly right now, or do something more like an introduction, or, you know, start again on the 11th, but try to be at that meeting.
So the 31st is the date for the calendar, the agenda for the meeting on the 6th.
Can we just keep it very general?
Yes.
conversation to review first quarterly report recommendations or something to that effect?
Yes. I made a note. And see that the agenda gets to Nick and he can do the posting for the 6th. Any other topics to discuss?
No.
Work up. It's gonna be better.
Sorry. No, I was just thinking, like, no, I think it's good if we keep talking, and it doesn't have to be a long meeting next time. But just, you know, figure out, like, yeah. Whether it's even just getting that thing on the schedule, like the open session.
I'll have some minutes for us to approve. That's another thing.
Mm-hmm. So do we want to try to get on the April 11th select board meeting? I guess that was the other question here.
I think so.
Okay. So then it would make a lot more definitely we should keep the 6th as our meeting then too.
Yes, we're going to do the 6th. And I'll set the agenda limited, but it's any topic that we might want to address on the 11th of April.
Okay, and then as far as getting on the agenda on April 11th, is that something Nick does, or we need to email someone, or?
Or I could tell Lynn Mills, who's the administrative assistant for the select board, to put us on their agenda.
Okay.
For the 11th.
Okay.
Any other thoughts?
I'm good with everything.
Choose to adjourn?
Second.
Everybody vote by voice. BJ, yes.
Nancy, yes.
Carl, yes.
David, yes.
Meeting's adjourned, everybody.
Have a great night.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.
Bye. Take care.